I'm Bara Sheiban. I work with the human rights charity Reprieve, which is based in London. I'm also a member of the National Dialogue Conference in Yemen, working on the Transitional Justice Working Group. So when I want to talk about counterterrorism, I would definitely start by what happened maybe before yesterday. What's the purpose of your visit to the UK? That's the question we've been asked every time we enter to the UK borders. And lucky for me, being a Yemeni and a human rights activist and arriving through Gatwick, the list of questions extended to, are you planning to kill the Queen? What do you think of what's happening in Somalia and Nairobi? Is your human rights organization causing problems in your country and you're here because of the bad things your organization have caused in your in your country? You realize the relationships between UK and Yemen are vital for us. A set of questions were asked by a UK security, border security officer before I was allowed to enter. I mean, the guy kept for an hour and a half threatening me every moment that he has the authority to detain me up to 9 hours. This is a power he has just by the UK borders. For many people inside Yemen, that power extends that they have the power to kill people without having court hearings, without having a lawyer, without having any investigations, just in the matter of being a terrorist suspect. I would start by telling the story of Faisal bin Ali Jaber. Faisal bin Ali Jaber is one of Yemen's most educated members of society. He has a master's degree in water and environment and has been heavily involved in the civil society work, specifically working in environment inside Yemen. Faisal's brother-in-law, Salem, was an anti-Qaeda imam and was known to give anti-Qaeda Friday sermons. The anti-Qaeda imam was killed after 1 week from giving an anti-Qaeda Friday sermon by a US drone strike. Now this all questions, who are we targeting and is the United States now starting to killing its allies? Faisal, along with his whole village, voted for Hadi in the early presidential elections, despite of so many pressure from the Southern movement to boycott the elections. In fact, Hadi's actual power come from that he came after a massive popular uprising. In fact, he came after he got the votes of more than 6 million people. So in other words, his real power come from the fact that his people voted for him. So the power comes from the people, not from his ties with any international force. Faisal quoted, I'm going to take a quote of what Faisal told me. He said, I found Hadi's pronouncement on drones to be very provocative and insulting to the victims' families. The US policy before used highly depending on funding national security and the political security to do their work for them. So sometimes the United States security officers would do the work and would detain people, but in many cases it would fund operations inside Yemen to detain people illegally. The detention would be done illegally. Those people would have no courts, no investigations, no hearings, no lawyers, nothing. But actually after the fact, I mean, if I mention Guantanamo is a way of holding people indefinitely. Guantanamo now where most of the detained people there today are Yemenis. In fact, now it's very unlikely that the United States can detain someone and take them all the way to Guantanamo because of the high pressure that comes from the people that Guantanamo should be closed, and this is an ongoing discussion. So I believe the new strategy the United States and its allies has been following inside Yemen, if we cannot detain them, we'll just kill them. In fact, those people who are living under drones are not just numbers that we see every day on newspapers. We see 3 people have been killed, 4 people have been killed, 5 people have been killed. The interesting thing that those people, and specifically when they start announcing the names of the people, have been killed more than once. In one case, they announced the killing of a Shehri, as an example, 7 times. Their questions, who have they been targeting for 7 times in a row? And I wouldn't be surprised if he appeared for the 8th time now. Inside the National Dialogue Conference, we discussed the matter of drones hovering on Yemeni villages very thoroughly. We discussed it in months' time until we reached to a decision by June 2012 that we should criminalize the killing outside of law by all means, including drone strikes and targeted missiles. The decision to reach to a decision inside the National Dialogue, you have to reach, first of all, to an agreement and the subcommittee, which is the Counterterrorism Committee, formed of 9 members. Then it should be approved by full consensus inside the Transitional Justice Committee, which is 80 members. And then it should get a full consensus inside the plenary session, which is at the 565. The fact that those people reached to this decision to criminalize the use of drones, in fact, in a conference where they debate about everything, and they would disagree about everything, and they cannot reach about an agreement about everything, but everyone, we reached to a full consensus regarding the use of drones inside Yemen. A Yemeni MP, I quote, said, I don't know, how are we going to implement the rule of law inside our cities when we have drones killing outside of law? When I talk about drones, I always remember Wafa, which was a 10 years old daughter. Wafa Bajash was killed in a strike that took place in Abyan, and till now, her father didn't get any explanation, no apology, no compensation, nothing from the government. When I also remember Abdul Aziz, who was killed just last June, he was a 10-year-old child. The interesting thing about Abdul Aziz that his father handed over his elder son of being suspected to being a Qaeda member. So he went to the governorate and handed him over himself, saying that you have accused my son to being a member of Al-Qaeda. I want him to go through the rule of law and to follow, like to have a court. And he handed over to the government. He was then released and then killed again by a drone strike with his younger sister, his younger brother Abdul Aziz, who was just 10 years old. Finally, I'd like to also mention a final story about Al-Bayda airstrike. Al-Bayda airstrike took place in a village where there are very limited resources. People don't have access to water, don't have access to goods, don't have access to services. They have to travel all the way from the village to the main city in order to get the goods, in order to go to the market. In the way back, they were killed by a drone strike, and one family lost a father, a mother, and an 8-year-old sister. I mean, this is one family losing 3 members in just one airstrike. Until today, the members of those family, 13 people were killed in that airstrike. Until today, they're trying to contact the authorities in Sana'a, but with no answer. The people living, I mean, it's important when I focus about the people living under drones and how are they living under drones. People living under drones, usually drones take place in the poorest areas in the country, where people have no access to resources. They have very limited education. They have absolutely no medical care. And yet what they were expecting from people like us working in civil society, people like you, all of us who are concerned about Yemen and trying to direct fund through the US aid, UK aid, European Union, all the international community aid to fund those resources, those people have never seen nothing, no project of those international players. The only thing they want from us in exchange that to try harder to make their life better, a bit better, and someone like Abdul Aziz to let him all like grow old. Maybe someday he will be able to work and make the life of his family better. The youth revolution that took place in 2011 had a dream that we're going to have a civil, democratic state. That state would bind by the rule of law. The fact is that that dream is being killed by each drone strike, killing every by each civilian being killed by a drone strike inside Yemen. The places where the strikes take place, a place like Marib. I have a friend from Marib. Her name is Intisar. She's a woman activist, and you cannot imagine how hard is it to be a woman activist living inside Marib. They held a women protest inside Marib, which was very significant and unique back then in 2011. Today, Intisar always tell me the fact is, I don't know what I'm going to tell the people that I'm trying to get the support of the international community. I'm trying to get projects to the area, while the fact that the US drones have been hovering day and night. The problem of the US drones does not stop about killing civilians. Actually, if we look into further, drones hover like day and night over the villages. You don't know when or where or what are they targeting. You can expect the strike to happen every day, every moment. In a recent research, we did a psychological research. Peter Shepfield, which is a British doctor, said that 99% of the people he interviewed had some kind of psychological impact due to the fact that drones are hovering on their heads. And he said 71% of the people he interviewed have definitely have a traumatic disorder, and that's after either an airstrike takes place or after they hear the buzzing of drones on their heads. The fact that drones are hovering on their heads does not allow, I mean, does not allow children to go to schools, does not allow people to leave, does not allow people to gather in public places. A lot of people tell me that we are now afraid of gathering in public places because we might be a target of those drones. The fact, the most important thing, that we're having a transitional period in the country. We have a political process in the country. And the people living in those villages cannot buy into a political process when they cannot live freely. They cannot just move from one area to another, not fearing the fear that they might be killed by a drone strike, and they don't know when or where the strike is going to take place. Finally, I would like to talk about the future generations we're creating under drones. If we have a whole community and children being raised to the sound of those drones, do you think it would be harder for AQAP to recruit those people in the future? Do you think it would be hard for them to say, though you've been killed repeatedly, your family members have been killed repeatedly by US drone strikes? This fact actually threatens the whole process. It threatens the process of moving into a new system, into a new future system. Yemen, for many Yemenis, is much more than just being Al-Qaeda. It's a 25 million population. It has dreams, it has desires, and everyone in Yemen today is talking about change, about moving to the future. The fact that they cannot give an answer to those people living under drones until today is absurd by itself. Why has the United States haven't given even a single apology? The answer is simply because every time an airstrike takes place, they have Hadi. They made sure that Hadi would say, these strikes have been taken under my approval. Well, in fact, the reality, most of the people, even the people right below Hadi, think otherwise. As an example, I gave you the National Dialogue members, which is a 565 constituents composed of all political factions in the country. I give you an MP, and I give you a number of civil society activists.
This is compelling stuff, but can you wrap up within the next sort of 30 seconds or so?
Sure. Cheers. Sure. I think it's important that we look closely and we think, what are we going to tell to the future generations when we tell them that we moved into a new system, but in the process, we killed more than 100 in just 1 year. Thank you.
My name's Iona Craig. I've been living in and reporting on Yemen for 3 years now. I have traveled around the country, but not as had as much access, perhaps, as my Yemeni colleagues have, but certainly more than the diplomatic and international community get when they come to Yemen. The few journalists that there are in Sana'a, we're not living behind high walls and in compounds, and we do get to get probably a better feel of what's going on in the country than others from the Western community. But as I say, you know, Yemeni journalists have a far better idea, really, of what's going on around the country than anybody else. But on that note, as media reports from Yemen really go, it all comes down to a few phrases normally. If you haven't had Yemen on the brink as one of your headlines, you probably haven't been reporting on Yemen for long enough. It'll happen eventually. There are other cliches that go with that. It's the failed state. It's the civil war is about to happen next week or tomorrow. And then, of course, it's Al-Qaeda. Those issues are really probably what's brought us to this point today. We ended up with a GCC deal, or Yemen did, in 2011, which then brought on the national dialogue because of that fear, because of those cliches of the failed state, the on-the-brink aspects that really stirred the Western and international community to prevent Yemen falling off that brink and ending up in the canyon at the bottom. I think really on the security aspect, there's a real risk still now of focusing on Al-Qaeda as being the main issue, as much as us journalists are guilty of portraying that as well. It's the Western community's focus, really. And I know they would probably argue that, hang on a minute, we were the ones that pushed for the GCC deal. We're supporting this national dialogue process. But as that process becomes increasingly difficult, as we get to a kind of crucial stage now, I'm sure a lot of them are feeling that they're banging their head against a brick wall and that the old issues of Saada, of the South, are still a real challenge, that once again Al-Qaeda becomes their focus. And this is what they tend to focus on in Yemen, at the risk of losing sight of the other security issues. If you look at what's happened in Yemen, even over the last few weeks, the last couple of months, the security challenges that have been going on, we've had sectarian clashes in Amran, again, up in Damaj in the north, around Ib. We've had, once again, attacks on the electricity and the infrastructure, on the oil pipelines. And with the international community looking at Al-Qaeda as the major problem, you're really ignoring all of these other issues that really then become part of the wider security problem. And of course, as was mentioned earlier, we saw this being manipulated in a way in the past where these other armed groups are used by the political elite to fight their own personal battles in the Saada wars when it was between Ahmed Ali and Ali Mussan. And I think there's a real risk of that now happening again, whether it be through sectarian fighting and even the manipulation of Al-Qaeda in that respect to be used as a form of proxy in those kind of political battles where we might not see the issue of civil war coming up again, but you have the old political elite using these internal armed groups for their own ends and becoming a problem for security, which is far greater for most Yemenis than Al-Qaeda is ever going to be. When I've traveled around the country, people's number one pretty much issue up there with, you know, food, water, and electricity is security. The one exception to that I found in the South, they tend to put the issue of separation above that. And security is a major issue for everybody. And again, that's not down to Al-Qaeda. This is down to armed groups in various parts of the country. And I think when it comes down to the issue of al-Qaeda and the way the international community has tried to fight that, again, we saw it in Abyan, is encouraging armed groups outside of the military to act as the local security groups in somewhere like Abyan is a serious problem. I think encouraging these popular committees, if that's what you want to call them, but they're essentially pro-government militias. I think in Yemen, of all places, encouraging unaccountable, untrained armed groups to be fighting on behalf of the government is not something that's A, necessary, and B, should be encouraged. I think, if anything, it should be the reverse. The other issue that kind of plays into this is, without wanting to get into the complexities of the many conspiracy theories that, of course, fly around Yemen, is, you know, al-Qaeda being blamed for everything that goes bang or every person that's being shot across the country. We saw it before in the build-up to the civil war in 1994 when you have assassinations that take place. I'm not here as an al-Qaeda denier, and they are an issue and are a problem, but I think the international community, and particularly the Western community, need to be more aware of those external factors to al-Qaeda really undermining the security in Yemen. If anything, they should have learned that from 2011. Once the political elite start fighting physically amongst themselves, that is actually when you're leaving the door open for an issue and a problem like al-Qaeda, and also the issue of al-Qaeda becomes manipulated by the political elite for their own ends. Okay. Yeah. And also going back to something that was said earlier today, corruption is one of, you know, the root or the core problems for national security. In a recent trip to Hadramaut, I spoke with the director of security for the whole of southern Hadramaut, who was saying to me, you know, this is kind of an area where America might see it as being the front line of the so-called war on terror. He doesn't have enough fuel to get him through. His allowance for a month will get him through 2 weeks at best in a good month. Similarly, I've spoken to military commanders whose expenses for their entire unit for a month is less than $20. And obviously, with the way that the military is now being reshuffled, there's also the issue of who's in control of power in the military, and that plays directly back to money, as we all know, whether that be via smuggling routes, through control over the areas where the oil companies are operating. And that all feeds in to the security issue and into the al-Qaeda problem. And as I'm being told to wrap up, I'll end by saying actually something Ibrahim Mathana said to me shortly before he passed away. He said, yes, there might be a light at the end of the tunnel in Yemen, but that light could be a train coming in the opposite direction. And I think when we work out whether that is a train or not, whoever's driving it, it's very unlikely to be al-Qaeda. And even if it is them, they won't be the only drivers. And I think the Western community really needs to be aware of that. And if they ignore that, then they do so at their own peril.
Until recently, 25 years with the U.S. Department of State, and now a senior fellow for Middle East and National Security with the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. I had intended to start this, to start my topic differently, and to end with a comment on drones, but given the dramatic presentation by my friend and colleague on that subject, as well as Iona's intervention, I think I'll start with that. And sorry to disappoint those who think I'm going to defend the use of drones and create an argument here. I don't defend the use of drones. For one thing, I am no longer in the position of a spokesman for the U.S. government, but even in the days when I was a spokesman, back in 02, 03, and up to 04, I always felt that my job was not so much to defend policies, but to explain them and to offer an opportunity to our critics in the region to send feedback through me to Washington and therefore to try to influence US policy. And I saw myself as a bridge between the two. So given where I am today and given a policy with which I strongly disagree, I will say that I think that drones are a very bad idea. And I think the drones used in a military situation, in battle, make military sense, because in war, that becomes a tactic, and becomes a tactic that is part of an overall military strategy. So Afghanistan is one thing, Pakistan is another, but Yemen is a completely different situation. In a country where you are not at war, and we are not at war with Yemen, then the use of the drones is no longer part of a military strategy, it becomes part of policy. In fact, you risk having it become the policy. And in fact, I think Hillary Clinton herself was critical, not so much of the use of the drones, but of the taking over of that military dimension of policy. Therefore, the over-reliance on drones. John Brennan, who is to some extent accredited with driving that policy, and also driving policy on Yemen for the years that he was at the NSC, one time in a speech in New York said something about Al-Qaeda, AQAP, having taken advantage of a vacuum in Yemen and therefore took that and established itself as a strong presence in Yemen. Well, the problem with that statement is that where did the vacuum come from in the first place? And that if you really have a comprehensive policy to fill that vacuum, then you work for the political and economic stability of Yemen. That would fill the vacuum, and that would mean that that would squeeze out Al-Qaeda in Yemen, therefore obviating the need to be chasing them with drones. The only thing I will add here is President Hadi, who has my utmost respect, and I think that Hadi has done an excellent job under very difficult circumstances. And from time to time, I've tried to send him some opinions, some advice, among which is that from time to time, you need to ignore what Washington is telling you. This is your country, this is not America's country. And therefore, you make the right decision and Washington will line up behind you. But don't go asking them first what you should be doing. And the last time when Hadi came to Washington, he and Secretary Kerry went up to the microphones for a statement. And it was President Hadi who gave first mention, and therefore first priority, to collaborating with the US on anti-terrorism measures. It wasn't Kerry who brought it up. Kerry tried to be more comprehensive and talk about economic and political development in Yemen. So I would say don't rush. This is something that former President Saleh also liked to do, to highlight that, hey, I'm your friend here, I'm cooperating with you on counterterrorism. My advice to President Hadi would be to put this in the background, not prioritize it. And his message to the US government should be, help me patch up the political differences and help me really develop Yemen economically. Give me a Marshall Plan for Yemen. And then the terrorism issue will take care of itself. We can take care of counterterrorism measures in Yemen. You don't have to do it yourselves. The problem, again, with drones is that Yes, there is some linkage here with Guantanamo. There is the catch-22 of Guantanamo, is that these people there are neither POWs nor civilians. They kind of fall in between. If in a situation of war, you're at war with another state, you have POWs. When that state of war ends, you exchange your POWs. Al-Qaeda is not a state. It's not about to end its war with the U.S. and the West. Therefore, it puts Guantanamo under, and the president, under a very difficult situation. He came into office promising to close down Guantanamo, and he has yet to do that after 5 years. The other problem, of course, is that by using these drones in a non-combat situation, you raise all these legal and constitutional issues precisely at the time when you're trying to encourage a country like Yemen to build new institutions, to rule according to the laws of governance, good governance, and drones are quite contrary to that policy. So I'm in full agreement that this is something that should end, and I call on President Hadi to start that process himself. It is his country, and it is his right to ask that this tactic not be used in Yemen. Now, very quickly, and I know this time is short here, there's been a problem in U.S. foreign policy from the start of the Arab uprising. And the problem is a tension between one national interest established by President Obama, which is the support of democratic transition in the Middle East. This was established by him in the Cairo speech before the uprisings and after, by saying, this is not just a value, this is in the national interest. And he has a good vision of the Middle East, and he has a good understanding of what's happening, and he wants to be on the right side of history. And he understands that democracy leads to stability, and stability leads to security for the region and for the United States. The problem is this conflicts with a traditional, more traditional view of security, which is, in the immediate sense, what do you do about the threat of terrorism in this country, in the region, et cetera. And this tension has been obvious from the start. And it was obvious in Egypt, it was obvious in Libya, it was certainly the classic case is Bahrain, where the U.S. fleet is based for the Gulf, and at the same time there is an uprising there by a majority in that country's population against an abusive minority ruling that country.
We've
tied ourselves up in knots in not being able to speak truth to the power in Bahrain, by telling them that they should move it on the reforms and stop dawdling and stop telling us not to interfere in their internal affairs. This problem is reflected in Yemen in that there's been a bit of ambivalence, uncertainty, and conflicting goals in Yemen. We were slow to recognize the need for Saleh to leave the presidency. We were slow in recognizing the need to have his family removed from the control of the security and military apparatus in Yemen. And luckily, Hadi did the right thing on those two issues and moved things along. And even though the military is kind of in limbo right now, but that's what happens when you're transitioning. There's a lot of detail that goes into developing the security apparatus of Yemen. No time to go into them here, but this is the next challenge for them. But at least he's taken the initial step. Without having removed the family from those positions, he couldn't have gone anywhere. In fact, he couldn't even have moved into the presidential palace had he not done that.
I've been working in Yemen since 2006, when Nabil was the deputy head of mission at the American Embassy in Sana'a. And I'll follow up from all of these speakers really by saying that the report tries to strike a balance by looking at the way that international actors have provided a force for stability, but also risk factors. We try to look at the issue around political legitimacy and the way in which the behavior and the priorities of international actors have had an impact on perceptions of political legitimacy in Yemen, and how those perceptions within the country vary really between different interest groups. To follow up really from the presentations from my earlier speakers on the panel, I feel that really that from 2006 onwards, terrorism has become a kind of lucrative part of Yemen's political economy. And you can see there that access to foreign military aid and the confidence that foreign powers express in leaders who are willing to cooperate with them on counterterrorism offers a really clear factional advantage. We saw that under Saleh. And in 2011, there was a really clear split in the military between the units that were receiving Western military aid and training and the units that weren't. And those relationships go right back to the USS Cole, actually, which was when the first division really emerged inside the Yemeni military over this question of cooperation with foreign powers. Hadi himself was a fairly unknown quantity at the beginning of 2012. And it wasn't really until May, I'd say May 2012, that US officials became convinced that Hadi was really somebody that could get stuff done. And his really early priority for him was defeating the problem in Abyan, which was his home province as well. Iona did a lot of reporting from Abyan, actually. The fact that he prioritized the security situation in Abyan was one of the reasons, among many, that the national dialogue got off to such a slow start. And Hadi knows that he owes his position to US confidence and also to Saudi confidence. And he knows that he needed, initially in that first year, the support of Jamal Ben Ammar personally, but Jamal representing the will of the UN Security Council to be able to enforce his decrees in order to dismiss Saleh's relatives and other figures from the military. John Brennan gave a really interesting interview in 2012 where he said that he had personally played a role in bringing a more cooperative government to power in Yemen by replacing Saleh with Hadi. And it was really interesting for me reading this and seeing the way that the international community adapted to events in Yemen during 2011. Because one of the research questions that dominated my visits to Yemen in 2010 was the possibility of any alternative to Saleh. And none of the diplomats that I spoke to were able to see an alternative or willing to consider the possibility that there might be an alternative. Whereas when I was talking to Yemeni opposition figures, the question they were asking me was whether the American government would be willing to accept an alternative to Saleh. And it seemed to me that the opposition figures viewed US position as decisive in their own calculation about whether or not it was time to step forward and confront the regime. And we heard in the earlier panel that division was coming inside the regime. It was just a matter of time. The views of foreign powers were considered to be decisive in that process. What we have now is a GCC deal, a president who is conciliatory and a partner in the counterterrorism operations, which obviously there is a security priority here. The British government, the American government, the Saudi government all view security is a really high priority for good reason. But it's really interesting to see the way that it interacts with this question of accountability, representation, and legitimacy in Yemen. Because one of the primary problems before the revolution was the fact that none of Yemen's political institutions were considered to be legitimate or to even be able to do the job. There haven't been parliamentary elections for 10 years, and the parties themselves were not really seen as being adequate vehicles for representing the will of their members or the people. And a point that the report tries to make quite strongly is that unless this transition process can improve political representation and accountability, and the risk that it could potentially reinforce that fundamental problem, that the parties and the state are not seen as being representative of the views of the people, Yemen is not going to lead towards a more stable basis for power. Just a few points on aid and reform. In the same way that Saleh's family were able to capture the narrative, really, as well as the money around counterterrorism and Western aid and training, They also had a monopoly on the reform agenda, and they had a monopoly on their interaction with the donors. And the Western donors have been pushing pretty hard in Yemen for the last 10 years to try to improve the governance environment. They all understand that this country is going through a transition to an economy without oil, and it has very little other resources to support itself. And there are a number of really obvious structural reforms that need to take place in the economy. And the donors have been trying really hard to push that. They've also been trying really, really hard to build up the result pledges to Yemen. So there's a conference in 2006 pledging about $5 billion, and over the last year we've seen that sum rise to over $8 billion. There's a really strong commitment to trying to make good on the rhetoric around a comprehensive approach to Yemen, understanding that security can't be seen in isolation, and it needs to be seen in the context of the economy and humanitarian issues. But there's still a huge problem around delivering that aid. There still tends to be a very technocratic approach to trying to encourage this sort of reform and spend the money. And we, in the political economy analysis, we went through the history of why those reforms hadn't happened under the previous regime. And we looked at ways in which those obstacles may or may not have been removed. And essentially, they are all politically highly costly reforms that the international community is encouraging the Yemeni government to make. Partly because it will increase hardship for ordinary householders, but also because it will unpick the patronage structures that are holding together a lot of the relationships that do the job that might be done by a state in another system. The final point I just want to make really is this question of capital flight. Pete covered the basics in the first session, but what's interesting about it is the way that when you look at Yemen through this frame, Yemen itself becomes a symptom of a much, much bigger problem. And it also fits into changes to the international financial structures that have taken place since the end of the Cold War. So we've looked at the way that there's been so much capital flight out of the country, really, in the 1990s and 2000s. A lot of what was going on under Saleh that passed for political activity was actually a squabble between different factions and individuals to have a greater control over the economy. And while they were trying to make money from that process, the money that they made has not stayed in Yemen. And a lot of those groups and factions and individuals have their own banking channels, which they use to transfer their money out of the country into a safer environment. Now, that undermines the domestic tax collection that would be able to support the state. And it leads to the symptoms that we see on the ground, which is weak institutions and weak property rights and low growth. So one of the arguments that we're trying to make is it's not just about governance reform in Yemen. It's about trying to create a better global governance environment. And that fits directly into the discussions that have been taking place at the G8 level and with the G20 this year about international tax reform, the role of tax havens, and greater transparency. There are proposals on the table now to try to improve that regime, but there's still a lot of questions around the details and whether or not developing countries will be able to join in this kind of system of better information exchange at an international level. If not, the danger is that whatever the new structures in Yemen and whatever the new faces, the same rules of the game will remain in play.